I want to introduce my subject matter by saying this is the best of the solas. You know, in systematic theology, we often take our discipline as the culminating best of the disciplines. Well, that's amen. That's right. But I can't think of a greater subject matter, and obviously all the solas are interconnected, right? And we've seen that over the last little bit, but Solus Christus, through Christ, in Christ, by Christ alone, is really what unites the solas. Obviously, it's grounded on Scripture that we've just heard, but it really is central to the solas and Christian theology. Right? And I just want to make a couple of comments there and then sort of sketch where the book is going and lay that out and discuss some important matters of Christ alone in our hour together. When you think of sola fide, right, it's faith in who, right? In whom, right? It's in Christ, right? So Christ alone grounds our faith in ultimately Christ alone in his work. Sola gratia, where do we find grace? Well, obviously in the triune God's work and act, but supremely in the Lord Jesus Christ. What's the great subject matter of Scripture? Well, a lot of things, but Christ is central to that, the triune covenant Lord and all of his plan and glory and his work. But in that eternal plan, the triune God, it's through the Son, it's through our Lord Jesus Christ that he becomes our mediator, our great prophet, priest, and king. So it's not an understatement to say that he, the Lord Jesus, is the heart and soul of Scripture and the gospel itself, right? Now, we're not minimizing, certainly, the triune persons. We'll come back to that just in a moment. It's simply when we say Christ is central, it unpacks the triune relations from eternity as they're worked out in the economy in terms of God's plan, which all resounds for God's glory, right? So that's a way of thinking of Christ alone uniting these solas, grounded in Scripture, to God's glory in the great work of salvation. We won't spend time looking at all the scriptural texts that would center the Bible in and the gospel in the Lord Jesus Christ. We could list many, but we'll leave that for some of the discussion in the book. In addition, Christ alone underscores crucial biblical truths. Obviously, what we just said, the centrality of the triune God, that he is the Lord of everything, right? That salvation, I mean, creation is from him. Providence, he's Lord. In salvation, he's Lord, and that's centered then in the Lord Jesus Christ. Solus Christus, as well, emphasizes the fallenness of the human creature, human sin. We cannot save ourselves, right? Only Christ alone. Obviously, only God alone, the triune God in Christ alone can save us. And if God is going to save, he must do it alone. Salvation is totally a work of God. It's grounded in Christ Jesus. The triune persons are working and acting inseparably to bring about his eternal plan in a complete, final, perfect, sufficient way in both accomplishment and application. And all of this is grounded in Christ alone. Now, how are we going to look at this today? And what's a sketch of where the book is going? Well, two major steps today, and it's really the second step that we're going to focus on in more detail. First of all, as was mentioned by Matt Barrett, the subtitle of all the volumes are What the Reformers Taught, Why It Still Matters. And so I want to reflect in part one here as to the challenge of confessing, professing Christ alone both yesterday in the Reformers and today, and see the similarities and differences. And then we want to think in part two, in light of those challenges, yesterday, today, we want to then think of why it is that we confess Christ alone and how we establish that biblically and theologically. So first, the challenge of confessing, professing Christ alone yesterday and today. Well, yesterday refers to primarily the Reformation era, since these are reflecting on the Reformation period, the solas of the Reformation. I think we could say, and there's probably more, but at least two aspects to Christ alone yesterday. first, obviously the most significant aspect is the Reformers' disagreement and separation from Roman Catholicism. Right? So Rome, with its sacramental theology, God's grace mediated through the church, Christ's death pays for our past and original sin in an objective manner, very much a satisfaction view of the cross, indebted hugely to Anselm. But in terms of our appropriation of Christ's work and dealing with our future sin, it's a combination of Christ's merit and the sacraments that then come through the church. We have access to this superabundant merit of Christ through our sacramental incorporation into Christ through the mediation of the body of Christ on earth, the church. Justification then and sanctification get blended, a process. With the aid and cooperation of grace, we are made righteous. The legal and the ontological are blended in terms of justification so that God cannot ultimately forgive us and restore us to relationship with Him except by making us righteous, ultimately, yes, through Christ, Orthodox Christology, but a flawed view of work and its application to us sacramentally through the church. So we have the intercession then of the saints and the human mediators that then crop up, the work of penance, the Mass, and all of its presentation of the reappropriation and bringing back the work of Christ to us in the present. The Roman Catholic Church added human achievements to Christ's work so that it was no longer possible to say that salvation was entirely by Christ and His atonement. Right? It's a tricky thing with Rome. Orthodox Trinitarian thought, Orthodox Christology, satisfaction view of the cross, but as it gets incorporated with the role of the church, Christ alone is lost. And the problem at its heart is it divorces a lot of things, but it divorces the believer from Christ. It undermines his sufficiency. It denies in the end that Christ alone who saves. Christ as the God the Son incarnate has paid for our sin, finally, once for all. He stood in our place as our covenant head in union with His people. Christ is the only mediator between God and humans and not the church. He has obeyed in life and death for us and His righteousness is imputed to us. The Spirit of God applies Christ's work to us and we receive it by faith alone. His sinless life and substitutionary atonement alone are sufficient for our justification. And any gospel that fails to acknowledge that or denies it is a false gospel. And the Reformation was absolutely necessary. Calvin says in the Institutes, he says, Christ stepped in, took the punishment upon Himself, bore the judgment due to sinners. With His own blood He expiated the sins which made them enemies of God, and thereby satisfied. And we looked to Christ alone for divine favor and fatherly love. The Heidelberg Catechism, as it wrestles with the role of saints, do such then believe in Jesus, the only Savior, who seek their salvation and happiness in saints, in themselves or anywhere else? The answer, they do not. For though they boast of Him in words, yet in deeds they deny Jesus, the only deliverer and Savior. For one of these two things must be true, that either Jesus is not a complete Savior, or that they who by true faith receive their Savior must find all things in Him necessary to their salvation. And you can repeat Zwingli. Matt Baird pointed out some places I saw in Zwingli here, the first Zurich disputation, 10 conclusions of Bern, these same statements that come through. Christ alone, He's sufficient. His work is done. Its application to us, sealing us by the Spirit, is enough. And of course, what's lost in the Roman Catholic view is ultimately the doctrine of justification, assurance of salvation, the finality of Christ's work, complete and done, our union with Christ and unique covenant, direct union with Him and covenant union, all of that is displaced by Roman Catholic theology. And so Christ alone functions to argue against the sacramental view of Rome, right? And it will still do that today as well. Now, also in the Reformation era, we see the beginning of the rise of heresies. Right? And every era has heresies, but particularly the rise of the Trinitarian heresies, denial of Christ's deity, undermining of Christ's substitutionary death, the efficacy of the cross. We see this in Servetus, the rise of Socinianism, later 16th century, the anti-Trinitarianism and all that has Christological implications. So in the Reformation era, we begin to see seeds of and people beginning to deny exclusivity, uniqueness, sufficiency of that work. So Rome doesn't deny exclusivity of Christ in that sense or an Orthodox Christology, but these later heresies rise. Then, of course, that spills into the Enlightenment and into our own day. So today, in one sense, the issues are the same, in one sense, but they're reversed, I think, in terms of order and priority. So those two issues in the Reformation are here with us today, nothing new under the sun. Yet in terms of emphasis and place, the challenge today is that of pluralism, the effects of Enlightenment, modern, postmodern, however you want to describe these eras. These are huge challenges then to Christ alone today. So first, in terms of the two challenges of the Reformation being reversed, there's a rejection of Christ alone now in terms of his uniqueness and exclusivity. We don't have time here to unpack how all of this occurred. We walk through intellectual history. We see a great example of what Richard Weaver called, and then Francis Schaeffer made popular, and others, ideas having consequences. Seeds that are sown way back in earlier eras that then eventually take full fruition to what we see in Enlightenment, to then modern, to postmodern, as the unfolding of these views as they move to our present day. David Wells, in a very helpful book a number of years ago, Above All Earthly Powers, rightly notes that Christology now takes place within a twofold reality. First, the disintegration of the Enlightenment world and its replacement by the postmodern ethos. And second, the increase of religious pluralism. These two intellectual and cultural developments have posed a number of serious challenges for Christ alone. The most important being the need for a defense of the uniqueness and exclusivity of Christ in a day of rampant philosophical and religious pluralism. Carl Truman at chapel yesterday mentioned Charles Taylor's work on the secular age. And he documents in there that how the conditions of belief from the medieval to the Reformation era to our day have changed. The plausibility structures, as it's often called. There's a sense in which we've said nothing new under the sun, but given these shifts, the Reformation era isn't exactly the same as our own, and we need to acknowledge that, right? We need to acknowledge that the debates today are here similar, yet we have to zero in and focus on what the issue of the day is, and clearly this is the major attack, the major issue before us. The secularization and pluralization of the West has altered the way people think because the conditions of belief have changed, and that's tied to entire worldview shifts. Charles Taylor then speaks of three distinct time periods pivoting around the Enlightenment. Before the Enlightenment, people found it impossible not to believe the Christian worldview. Not that they're all Christians, but that governed their thinking. Starting with the Enlightenment, it became possible not to believe in the basic truths of Christianity. 300 years later, after the Enlightenment, and the rise of postmodern pluralism, most people find it impossible to believe in the objective truths, ultimate concerns of the Christian worldview. And of course, this has impact on whether Solus Christus is plausible, whether it's credible, whether it's logically coherent. And of course, the major challenge today is whether it's even conceivable. Right? Lessing's old question in the Enlightenment era, how could this one life, let alone the death of this one man 2,000 years ago, be the salvation for humans and have universal significance? Well, that was an Enlightenment question, and it's here with a vengeance. Pluralism's answer, well, if there's a place left for Jesus at all, it's only as another religious figure, but certainly not in terms of Solus Christus, right? And we have to face that. That's where the issue is. The issue of truth is before us in a way that it wasn't there exactly the same in the Reformation era. Now, with that said, we still have ongoing Roman Catholic theology as it's morphed in its various ways, especially since Vatican II and the present Pope running around. And with the other evangelical confusions on the sufficiency of Christ, I mean, in evangelical thought, as we've seen in Sola Scriptura, evangelical thought on Christology is hugely debated, right? Chalcedon serves as a basic framework, but boy, once you start probing beneath it, things change quite drastically in terms of people's Christology. Debates on the atonement are huge today. Old debates that showed up in the end of the Reformation era are alive and well today with a vengeance. Inclusivism, Christ alone as Savior, and all of these issues are with us today, as well as Roman Catholicism. So that's yesterday, today, right? We have to bring the Reformation truth of Christ alone to our present day, right? We have to stand on the shoulders who have gone before us, and we also have to address the day before us and defend it, establish it, profess it, confess it gladly in our day, and do so as the Reformers would have done in their day. So this leads now to part two. So part one, and in the book, we then just lay out yesterday, today, setting the stage for then our present discussion of it. What does it matter for us today? Well, in part two, when we begin to look at how do we establish and defend Christ alone today, right? Why do we believe Christ alone, right? In the light of pluralism, salvation issues, so on, that are with us, is Christ's work sufficient? Is he alone exclusive? Is he unique? What is required to defend this? In one book, you can't say everything, can you? So the first thing that would have to be done, which I do not discuss other than just simply mention it, which is crucial, right? Defending all of these doctrines is a whole theological apologetic task, right? They're not just isolated, right? So apologetics is crucial at this point. Christ alone must be placed within an entire worldview theological argument. Right? And that worldview must be set over against its competitors. Right? So we need self-attestation, authentication. We need to be able to think theologically and apologetically, present Christ in all of the presentation the Bible gives over against the competitors, and then seek to do a whole apologetic argument for Scripture, Christian theology, and then Solus Christus. Right? That's not the purpose of the book. Right? So that is obviously part of what we would do. The next thing we do, which is what I zero in on, is we need to also now give the biblical theological grounding. We need to lay out the internal logic of Scripture. Right? Scripture comes as a unit, and it presents Christ holistically. We need to lay out the internal logic of Scripture, its storyline. We need to do what Paul did at Athens by speaking to his contemporary hearers, by setting the Christian view as a whole package over against their viewpoint, and setting Christ within that viewpoint, within that biblical framework. Not only do we look at individual texts that focus on Christ's deity, his humanity, his work, but we need to see that these individual texts are part of an entire biblical storyline, by an entire biblical framework. Jesus does not come to us de novo. He comes to us rooted in the Old Testament, in the categories and framework of Scripture, to make sense of who he is, what he does, penal substitution, all these debates today. We need the full orb biblical package and the theological package that goes with it. To establish the importance of the exclusivity of Christ's identity, to ground it in Christ alone, we need it warranted from the entire biblical presentation. My overall contention is that if we trace out the Bible's entire storyline through the biblical covenants, on the Bible's own terms, in the Bible's own content, structures, and categories, the entire Bible teaches that Jesus is, this is who he is, God the Son incarnate. He's in a unique category all by himself, and he has done everything necessary for our salvation, and we can't save ourselves, only he can do it. Right? I mean, that's the message that comes through from Genesis all the way to Revelation. So in terms of the Bible's own presentation, why then Solus Christus? Well, because of who he is, his identity, because of what he does, set in the context of God and sin and all the biblical teaching. In fact, apart from him and his entire covenantal work as last Adam, the true and final prophet, priest, and king, his life, death, resurrection, ascension, Pentecost, there is no salvation the way the Bible and, of course, the Reformers describe it. Thus, to demonstrate Christ alone from the Bible, and as an exercise, legitimate exercise in doing theology, it's crucial to establish something of not only the uniqueness of this person, but the necessity of this person. Right? The necessity of the kind of person he is, the work he does, right, to establish alone, you can't have another redeemer, right? You can't have one who can do another work. He alone in his person and work is necessary to do it. Apart from him, there is no salvation. Now, in this second part here, I'm aware of time. I know that I'll never get through what I have here. That's why there's going to be a book, right? But let me just sketch here at least what I was hoping to do. And I'm already telling you I probably won't do it, but I may sketch where it's going. First, I want to step in this second part here, moving four steps. I want to speak a little bit about this question of necessity. Right? So I want to tie Solus Christus to a discussion of necessity, Christ alone, because his person and work is necessary. What do we mean by that? For the kind of redeemer we need. And then establish, could do more than this, but at least five biblical theological building blocks. Right? So in some sense, we're stepping back. This is where, even in doing biblical theology, you need systematic informed biblical theology in your reading of Scripture. So five biblical theological building blocks grounded in Scripture storyline, which are crucial to making sense of Christ alone in both his person and work. And then thirdly, this is where it will get dicey in terms of time, begin to look at a few texts that link person and work together beautifully, that tie it back to the entire storyline, that speak of the necessity of this one to come. Particularly, I'm thinking here of Hebrews 2, and then linked with other areas of atonement. It's already been mentioned yesterday, Romans 3, 25 and 26, the whole rationale for the cross. Hebrews 9, and then Gethsemane, right? And then see if we can finish with some concluding thoughts, right? All right, let's first look at Christ alone and necessity of Christ's person and work for our salvation. Necessity is a tricky, tricky word in theology, philosophy, but we're thinking here in terms of systematic theology. There are a variety of senses to it, and to establish it is not easy. Yet to unpack and defend the exclusivity and uniqueness of Christ, some kind of necessity is required, right? Aloneness. He alone can save. His work is necessary for our salvation. This is not new in theology. It's not new in Scripture, right? Think of Anselm. Anselm is probably most famous for this, but Athanasius is doing the same thing in the early church. Anselm says, by what logic or necessity did God become man? Cur Deus homo. And by his death, as we believe and profess, restore life to the world when he could have done this through the agency of some other, angelic or human, or simply by willing it. What necessity could he have done in another way? And of course, Anselm is wrestling with that. In the post-Reformation era, Francis Turretin, John Owen, right, pick up this question as well. Right? In our own day, John Murray, Redemption Accomplished and Applied, has a whole chapter on, as he begins that book, on the necessity of Christ and particularly the cross. He says the question of necessity is not a vain curiosity. This isn't just a speculative kind of thing. He says, quote, to evade this issue of necessity is to miss something that is central to the interpretation of the redeeming work of Christ, and to miss the vision of some of its essential glory. Why did God become man? Why, having become man, did he die? Why, having died, did he die the accursed death of a cross? Unquote. This is the question of necessity. And answering it helps make sense of the biblical teaching, establish also a grounding and warrant for Christ alone. How do we communicate Christ alone, pluralistic age? Because he is necessary, right? You can't have salvation apart from him. Now, what exactly is meant by necessity? Well, there's a range of options. There's two extremes that must clearly be avoided, right? So if we think of sort of a necessity in a fatalistic sense, right? So you can maybe even call that kind of absolute necessity. God is circumscribed by something outside of himself. Well, that's clearly not a biblical position. Or you have, in the sense of the sort of voluntarist view that shows up Middle Ages, affects even some of the Reformation, gets picked up in the Socinians in some sense. Maybe even today, contemporary pluralism is so diverse, but this idea that there's really no necessity to the incarnation, right? There's no necessity to Christ's death and work, right? Pluralism, you don't need him at all for a variety of reasons, but you think of back in the voluntaristic era or the Socinian era, God could forgive apart from payment for sin. That's clearly the Socinian view that begins to creep in at the end of the Reformation. For the Socinians, retributive justice was a voluntary exercise of the divine will, not tied to the very nature of God. Hence, God was under no necessity to punish sin. He could simply forgive. And then you have various then views wrestle with, well, can God forgive without punishment of sin? How do we make sense of the cross and its necessity? Right? Now, those two views, I think, need to be eliminated. So within Orthodoxy, we have two other options, probably more, but at least following Murray here, he lays out this, and Oliver Crisp discusses this in some of his articles and so on, where there's this now hypothetical necessity. Augustine, possibly Aquinas, early Calvin seems to be this, Grotius, different people arguing different views of the atonement. But the idea here is that God could have chosen some other way of salvation than Christ and his cross, yet, they will say, he chose this way. So it's hypothetical in the sense of God could have, but he chose this way. This is most fitting, and this is usually then tied to his plan. Right? Now, the problem with this view, if not careful, this view seems to assume that there's nothing in the nature of God or in the nature of forgiveness of sin which makes Christ and his cross necessary, absolutely necessary. It's necessary in the sense that it's fulfilling the God's plan, but there could have been another way. Now, hypothetical necessity goes in a number of directions. It goes in a governmental direction. The cross is the chosen means of vindicating the moral law, the rectoral justice, the moral law and government of God, rather than as a means of satisfying divine justice in a retributive sense. So there's a pitting of rectoral versus retributive understanding of justice. God is able in the governmental view because they do not tie directly the law of God to the nature of God. It's more of God adjudicating moral law. God is able to relax divine retribution towards sinners. Christ is necessary in restoring rectoral justice, his governments of the world. But there's an implication of this, a very serious implication, I think an unbiblical implication. The moral law of God is not directly tied to God's nature. The moral law is not internal to God. It's more of an effect of the will. So it's sort of a voluntaristic understanding. Hence, that's the reason why rectoral justice, the governing of the universe, is more fundamental than retributive. It's how God can relax retributive justice. Now, they still argue for necessity. God, it's necessary. This isn't Socinianism. It's a necessity to uphold the moral law of God. Right? And then they have other things that the atonement will do. That's one form of hypothetical. Now, penal substitution is another form. It would not privilege rectoral justice over retributive, so God chose Christ to serve as our penal substitute, but it still will say, in this hypothetical sense, in maybe the wisdom of God and the omniscience of God, there might have been some other way. He didn't choose that way, but there may have been some other way. So that the implication seems to be that nothing in God's nature and the forgiveness of sins necessitates Christ and his work other than, obviously, the ordained purposes of God, which is, of course, crucial, but is there something more? Now, there is another view called consequent necessity, or consequent, sometimes the word absolute is put there as well. This is what Owen seems to affirm, Turretin, Murray. This is what I will say in a very, let me say I can't be for sure, but I think this is the best way to put the data together. What does consequent refer to? Well, consequence clearly saying God freely chooses. From eternity, God chooses in his sovereign grace. There's nothing constraining God. He's supremely free. He's free to act graciously. He's free to choose. He didn't have to save. He chooses to save. Yet in choosing to redeem as a consequence of his choice, Christ and his work is necessary in the absolute sense, in the sense that there's no other way. There's no other possible way. And this is a strong claim because if you bring in possible world language today, there's no possible world in which the triune God could accomplish his salvation in any other way than this way if he chooses to save us, which he has chosen to do. Right? Necessity then is arising in this view from the perfections of God's own nature. In other words, it assumes a specific understanding of the relationship of moral law to God's nature, the nature of divine justice as justice can be a lot of things, but at the heart retributive, and thus the necessity of God acting in a specific way to human sin if God is to be God. It highlights the important truth that Christ alone, atonement debates, salvation debates are in their end. I've been saying this for a few years, but Vidu in his recent book says this as well. They're God debates, right? Atonement debates are doctrine of God debates, right? And it's because of this that there is a specific kind of God that seems to undergird, a specific presentation of God in Scripture that undergirds Solus Christus. Now, what kind of necessity should we argue for? Well, minimally, hypothetical necessity has to be the case, right? God has chosen this way. Right, clearly, that's so. Augustine, Calvin, others are clearly on the right track here. This will provide, if we move away from the governmental view to penal substitution, a strong grounding for Christ alone. God has chosen him to be Redeemer. There's no other way in God's plan and decree for that to be the case. Yet, minimally, right? So minimally we have to move that direction, but yet I'm convinced that we can and I think must say more. We can certainly affirm that Christ and his work is necessary and fitting in terms of God's plan, but God's own, the Bible's own presentation of these, the logic of it, the linking together of God and sin and forgiveness and how it's presented isn't just sort of, yes, this is the way he's done it, but there seems to be more of an absolute necessity. Given God's choice to save, there is no other way to save us. This is how he can save us, and this alone, right? So, hypothetically, if I can't demonstrate this, then certainly we move hypothetical necessity in a penal substitution way. But I think there's more going on here, and I think Murray and Owen and Turretin and others are on the right track, which gives even greater grounding to Christ alone. Why him? Because he's the only one who can save. Right? Now, second step in this part two here is five crucial biblical theological truths that I think undergird Christ alone. So, necessity is sort of framing our discussion here. These truths now must be brought to the table and then come back to the question of what kind of necessity is it, right? Well, first biblical truth that we have to start with is the doctrine of God, right? And obviously, a lot to be said here. I'm going to just simply say here, the first point that we have to emphasize is the triune covenant Lord. The triune covenant Lord. In discussing the theology of atonement, John Stott, in his very, very helpful book, Cross of Christ, rightly says this. He says, if the essence of the cross is substitution, the theological inference is that it is impossible to hold the historic doctrine of the cross without holding the historic doctrine of Jesus Christ as the one and only God-man and mediator. At the heart of every caricature of the cross, there lies a distorted Christology. I think he's right. But I would also add, you can't have a Christology without the Trinity. So at the heart of the atonement, not only lies distortions, lie distorted Christology, you also have a distorted theology proper as well. In systematic theology, it's not just a truism to say that everything begins and ends with God. That's the way the Bible begins and ends, and that's true. That's so foundational. And he is the triune covenant Lord. Trinity. Why the emphasis on Trinity? Who Jesus is cannot be understood. The biblical data regarding who he is cannot be understood apart from the triune persons and relations. Who is he? He's the Son. He's God the Son. His whole identity is the Son of God in relation to the Father, in dependence upon the Spirit, as we see in the Gospels. He is the Son who has become incarnate. Why is he unique? Because he's the divine Son. What he does cannot be understood apart from the Trinity as well. It's the Son who becomes flesh. Even the very rationale for why the Son, not the Father and Spirit, I think is bound up in the internal intra-Trinitarian relations. It's the Father who sends the Son who bears our sin and the Father's wrath. Yet, the Son does so in an unbroken unity with the Father and Spirit, since they share the same identical nature. That's very important in debates over penal substitution and rejections of it and character. Trinitarian view is crucial here. God is not Christ is not a third-party individual, independent of the Father and Spirit. At the cross, we don't see three actors, the Father, us, and the Redeemer. No, we see two. We see God the Son incarnate, the triune God in and through the Son and us. Right? And these become crucial areas of getting the work of Christ right, as well as why he alone can do it. The cross is the very demonstration of the Father's love. Makes no sense apart from Trinitarian relations. Covenant, triune covenant, is all under doctrine of God. I'm not thinking here primarily in terms of the biblical covenants in history. I'm thinking of what's been called in Reformed theology the covenant of redemption, or the pactum salutis. However we want to talk about that, I do think Scripture is clear. The triune God has a plan. I would say it's covenant of redemption. I'm happy with that terminology. Some people don't like it, but we'll say He has a plan. He has a plan of salvation. He has a plan for this world before the foundation of the world. In that plan, the divine Son, in relation to the Father and Spirit, is appointed. He's appointed as the mediator of His people. And He gladly, voluntarily accepts this appointment. The covenant stipulation and promises, which then in history is worked out in terms of His incarnation, life, death, resurrection. He's on mission. He's fulfilling the Father's will. It is this plan which not only establishes Christ as mediator, but defines the nature of His mediation and assigns specific roles to each person of the Godhead. None of the triune persons are pitted against each other in the plan of redemption. All three persons equally share the same nature and inseparably act according to their mode of subsistence as Father, as Son, and as Spirit. In addition, it is this plan which unites Christ as mediator to His people, as our representative and substitute, so that in His work, God the Son incarnate acts as our new covenant mediator in a specific and definite way in order to accomplish our eternal redemption. Everything Christ does in His incarnation, life, and work is defined by this plan, by this covenantal context. And all of this is the result of the triune God's gracious choice in eternity. And then lordship, unpacking still our doctrine of God, triune, the plan of God, and Lord. Scripture declares that God is the Creator and Lord, the sovereign ruler and King of the universe, uncreated, all-sufficient, in need of nothing outside Himself. There's one point that I want to pick up here that I think is so crucial in our day, and a day of panentheism and open theism, and I think Arminian thought as well, divine aseity. Divine aseity speaks of God's self-sufficiency, independence, lordship. But aseity is not just that in terms of His self-existence. John Frame, I think, has been very helpful in his doctrine of God, saying we need to think of self-sufficiency, independence, not only in terms of self-existence, metaphysics, epistemology, knowledge. He is self-attesting. His knowledge is not dependent upon the creature. He is the one who knows all things and plans all things. But also in morality. And this becomes crucial tied to the cross. He is self-justifying. God is the standard. God is the law, right? All human courts are just simply finite courts, execute law, but God's moral law is Himself, right? Law is not outside of Him. This is the problem with the governmental view. As the Lord, He chooses to enter into covenant relationship with His creatures through the first man, Adam, but He demands, as the Lord, who is the standard, He demands, Tom Schreiner picked this up yesterday, He demands from us what you would expect, complete loyalty, complete obedience. The grounding to perfect obedience is that He is the Lord and you're not, right? And He demands from you obedience fully. Now, a crucial implication of this is a moral universe. But the moral universe isn't outside of God. I mean, it's ultimately rooted in the nature and character of God. Repeatedly, the triune God is identified as the Holy One, the Judge, the King. Abraham appeals to Him. He is the standard by which he appeals to. For those familiar with the new perspective on Paul, which often links righteousness and justice to covenant faithfulness, there's a truth, there's a sense in which the Bible does say that God remains true to His promises. He's righteous in that way. Yet first and foremost, righteousness, justice, and holiness is tied to the very nature of God, right? That's the kind of God He is. He is the one in His very moral nature. He's the standard. He's the law. He is that which we ultimately sin against. Of course, this is what warrants the concept of retributive justice. This is not a Western construct of law, but reflective of God's very nature. This is why sin against this God requires and necessitates God to judge, to punish, to display wrath, right? Holiness intrinsic, but in light of sin, He will express His holiness. Ultimately, in Scripture, death is viewed as the wages of sin, and it takes on penal suffering. And of course, either we pay for it under God's judgment and right condemnation, or there hopefully is another, right? The second truth, right? There's the first doctrine of God that has to be laid on the table. And most discussions today on the work of Christ that move away from, I think, reformational thought at this point and biblical thought is a doctrine of God crisis, right? There are different conceptions. Secondly, Adam and the creation covenant, ultimately leading to Christ as last Adam. Romans 5, 1 Corinthians 15, in some sense, the whole covenantal unfolding. Making sense of why the incarnation, why Christ the Son, the eternal Son, had to become like us, why he had to die. The nature of his work also requires an understanding of Adam. See, that's strange. Well, not in biblical thought, right? Adam and ultimately covenantal context at creation. Who are the two most important individuals in Scriptures? A lot of important individuals. Paul will reduce them to two, Adam and Christ. In God's plan, Adam, Romans 5:14, is the type of Christ who anticipates the last Adam. Adam is not only the first man, but also the covenant head. He is the representative of the human race. Adam's headship has a deeper privilege of more than just ordinary fatherhood. It includes the defining of what it means to be human, and through his representative and covenantal legal work, there's a legal context here, his act of disobedience brings to us death. The theme of disobedience is important. Not getting into a whole debate over covenant of works and everything else, but I have no problem with notion of something of obedience there that's commanded at the very beginning. Minimally, we can say that Adam, as a creature of God, as our covenant head, was called to covenant loyalty, complete obedience. The tree of the knowledge of good and evil functions to test whether Adam will be an obedient, image-bearer son, or whether he will disobey. Sadly, he disobeys. The consequence of his action is not private. We are born in Adam, depraved, deprived, corrupt, and guilty. And this impacts the entire creation. The tree of life holds out, I think, an implied promise of life, yet in light of sin, Adam's expelled from the garden. An act of hope in some sense, in light of the promise, but it's also an act of judgment. It is within this covenantal framework that Christ's person and work is placed and interpreted. Christ's work is covenantal. By his obedience, he ushers in a new covenant. Covenant establishes his work as representative, legal, and substitutionary. Yet in order for Adam's sin to be undone, reversed, and paid for, it requires a seed of the woman. That's all from Genesis 3:15 on. But also a greater Adam. One who will not disobey. One who will not be merely another Adam. He will be. But he will be the Lord of glory, the divine Son, the true image of God, who in his obedience, his life and death, removes the curse, pays for our sin, and ushers in a new creation. Here's the rationale for why the Son must become incarnate man, tied to the humanity's role, tied to Adam in creation. Yet in his incarnation and work, he must be greater. He must be greater because of the next truth here, bringing together our doctrine of God and the role of humans and the incredible role that we have as humans. In Adam, together now with sin, the nature of the human problem. It's an understatement to say that Genesis 3 is crucial in the Bible storyline. That's why, to remove it from history, we're in big trouble. Sin is against God, a very specific kind of God in history. We must maintain the distinction in history between what we were made good and now what we are is fallen. Sin is revolution at the heart of the universe, a reversal of the created order. Adam, as our covenant representative, disobeys, takes us all down. But God's promise in Genesis 3:15 says, I will not leave you to yourself. And this is part of his eternal plan. He chooses to provide a redeemer. The promise in embryonic form anticipates the coming of a redeemer, a seed of the woman. It will come through the human race, another Adam. Yet he will destroy the works of Satan. He will bring anew, I think in the context, there will be reversal of the effects of fall. But how will this come about? Will it be an act of power simply? Will it just be merely an example, show us a better way? Well, as Scripture unfolds, it becomes clear that in order to restore the creation, to destroy death, to reverse the effects of sin, to make us right before the triune covenant Lord, something more than a power encounter has needed. Something more than an example of God's love or even some kind of suffering that upholds the moral governance of the universe. Indeed, what's needed is a substitute who stands legally and representatively in my place, who obeys perfectly, who bears my individual sin and guilt by propitiating God's wrath and achieving my justification. Now, why is this so? Well, this is what Stott lays out so helpfully in his Cross of Christ, what he calls the problem of forgiveness. What is this problem? Well, it's basically the collision of bringing together the God of the Bible and our human sin. God is the moral standard of the universe. He is the law. He is holy and just. But if God chooses to save, how does he forgive us of our sin, which is sin against him, and not deny himself? He cannot overlook our sin. He cannot relax the retributive demands of his justice because it's tied to him. Right? God must punish because our sin is against him. Sin is not first against an external order outside of him. It's against God. Right? The great question of Scripture, it's not the question of our day, right? The great question of Scripture is, how am I made right before a holy God? That's the question. Not all the other things that our society asks is the problem. The problem of forgiveness is an internal problem for God, internal within himself. How can God be both just and justifier of the ungodly? Paul thinks this way in Romans 3. How can he initiate in his love and grace to save, yet remain just and holy in forgiving our sin? He must first satisfy himself. That is why substitution is necessary in a specific kind of person who can act as our substitute, namely a divine substitute. We need a human one. That's what the role of Adam is. But we also need one who's the Lord. Since the problem of forgiveness is in God himself, ultimately it's God who forgives. It is God himself who must satisfy his own righteous judge. God isn't just the judge who gets off the bench. God is the Lord of the universe. We cannot save ourselves. God must act on our behalf to satisfy his own righteous requirements, and he's done so in his Son. And ultimately, this is what is grounding Christ alone. Now, critics of penal substitution just go after this. I won't spend time looking at Joel Green, Mark Baker. We'll bring them up in the book. The latest diatribe is Darren Snyder Belisek, which does some awful things in that volume in terms of justice and retributive justice and this type of thing. But in the end, they give the impression when, say, Green and Baker will say, in the prodigal son, you don't have the father receiving the son back and saying, you have to provide satisfaction for me. When Jesus forgives the paralytic in Mark 2, he does it without any reference to sacrifice. Well, what are we to make of these kind of statements? Are we simply to think that God can simply forgive without atonement? Is the cross necessary for our salvation? What is the proper relationship between sin, punishment, law, and God? To be faithful to Scripture, we must surely say that the law of God is the very nature of God. It's inextricably related to his personal, moral, holy character. That's why there's a problem of forgiveness internal to God. God, in order to forgive us, cannot deny himself. He can't arbitrarily forgive without full payment for sin. And retributive justice is at the center of this. Now, this, I think, is the fourth truth here, is a major lesson as you work through the entire biblical covenants. Now, the biblical covenants give us a lot of things, and there's lots of debates on them and their impact and everything else, but I think we do the biblical covenants disservice if we don't see what the main message is. And the unfolding of the biblical covenants gives us a main message. And what's the main message of the biblical covenants, right? Well, it's how God's plan is going to come about, be enacted, and executed. God's initial promise in Genesis 3:15 is given greater definition and clarity through the covenants. As God's plan unfolds through those covenants, we see who will save, how he will save, why he, the who saves us, is necessary. On the one hand, Scripture teaches that the fulfillment of God's promises will be accomplished through a man. And that's developed all the way from Adam through all the covenant mediators, Moses, Israel, David. Christ takes up all of that in terms of New Testament Christology. He's the greater David. He's the true Israel. He's the greater than Moses. He's the last Adam. And all those ways, he fulfills those patterns. They all fail. They all disobey. Even the best of them are miserable. But he does not fail. On the other hand, Scripture also teaches that this Messiah is more than a mere man. He's identified with the Lord. How so? Well, he's the one who inaugurates God's saving rule. That's an act of God. He shares the very throne of God. Think of earlier passages, Psalm 110 and other places, something no mere human can do. This entails that his identity is intimately tied to the Lord, right? His identity is that he is the Lord who comes. He's not the Father. There's a distinction of person, yet he is the one who brings the rule and reign of Yahweh, right? And most of all, this is at the heart of the new covenant, he achieves forgiveness of sin, right? All the debates over new covenant and the newness of the new covenant and everything else, what's the heart of the new covenant? Right? The heart of the new covenant is Jeremiah 31:34. For I will remember their sins no more. Set in the context of the old covenant, that it is set in the context of, yes, God proleptically and typologically forgave their sins. There was salvation, obviously the same basis in the Old Testament, one plan of salvation, and so on. Yet it ultimately was not fully realized. In the Old Testament, forgiveness of sin is given through normally faith in the promises of God through the sacrificial system. But the Old Testament believer knew, and especially as the prophets picked this up, this was never enough. There had to be something more, and Jeremiah signals that, right? There's coming a day when the new covenant will dawn. God will put away sin permanently. That's how Hebrews takes, I will remember their sins no more, right? How does this come about? Well, by the King who is human, but also the one who is the Lord. It's the Lord alone who must act. Salvation is of the Lord. After all, who ultimately achieves the forgiveness of sins other than God alone? If there is to be salvation at all, the triune God himself must save. And he must save through this one who is human, but also the Lord. And of course, there's the beauty of Christ who comes as the Lord, who is the man. Right? And then, of course, fifthly, Christ alone in terms of these truths. Christ alone is grounded in Orthodox Christology. Right? Sometimes we've been unpacking that, but Solus Christus cannot be sustained without Orthodox Christology. The uniqueness of his identity, who he is, has to be understood in terms of he is deity, he is the Lord, he is the Son, he is God the Son. This is the primary answer to the scandal of historical particularity of Lessing and our day. How does this one man bring about salvation for people that have never, you have to hear about him, or he's lived at different times, or how can 2,000 years ago a death have impact for me today because of who he is? He is the Son incarnate. This one man has universal significance because of who he is in the very plan of God, right? And the exclusivity of his work is tied to the fact that it's a divine human work. This is predicated on a proper person-nature distinction in Christology. The person of the divine Son is the one who acts, who dies, who obeys, who lives through both natures. So there's a communication of predicates to the person. So that what the person is the one who acts, but he acts in and through human nature, divine nature, proper Chalcedonian Christology. And this is why his work as the Son of God has infinite value. Because he's the person. He's the divine Son who is fully God, fully man. His infinite value is not measured in some kind of quantitative calculus. It's he is the Lord. And his death is sufficient. His death is infinite. He is God the Son who dies. And you have then the legal representative and substitutionary nature of his work is grounded in a proper Christology. Here is where the incarnation is necessary for Christ's work and to be what it is. In order to redeem us, Christ had to act with us and for us. With us in incarnation, identification. He had to identify with our humanity. In order to restore us, to undo the work of Adam, he had to become man like us. He had to act in that humanity, in his obedience. But he also had to act for us. In the case of Christ, he is the sinless, perfect Son. He has no personal understanding of sin. 2 Corinthians 5:21. How does he bear our guilt? Because he acts for us. He acts for us, yes, voluntarily, as part of God's plan, but he acts for us as the divine Son. The divine Son who is fully God, fully man. It's God himself who takes up his own righteous demands in the Son. Don MacLeod rightly stresses this. He says, as God, he was the offended party. And he says, he had the right to demand satisfaction from the other. Instead, by becoming man, he qualified himself to become the other. and in the name of that other to atone for the offense. The Son of God became the last Adam. This conserves the principle that the atonement must be made in the nature that sinned. Jesus offered human obedience for us, right? So you have to bring all of that together. He's the divine Son who acts in and through as the Son through that human nature. He dies, yet he is the one who is God incarnate, right? God the Son incarnate. All of that's necessary. Those are the five building blocks. I warned you, that was the main part, and I'll summarize the rest now. But those are the building blocks that undergird this sense of these are biblical truths that are brought right across the storyline of Scripture. The God of the Bible, creation, all of it centered about him, triune relations, Adam, fall, plan of redemption, proper Christology, all of that is necessary to unpack, to ground, to warrant Christ alone. Now, as we think of some texts here, Hebrews 2, I'll just refer you to this particular passage. If you have it here, I mean, you can go home and meditate on it. We'll develop it in the book. But this is a crucial passage. It's one of the passages that we have in the Bible that is closest to answering Anselm's question. Why did God become man, right? In the book of Hebrews, in chapter 2, verses 5 to 18, you have a lot of necessity language that's put here, right? And in the larger context, the author begins with that opening thesis that establishes that God has spoken in the past. He has made himself known supremely, finally, in the Son, whom the prophets look forward to. That staggering claim is true because of who it is that this Son is. He is the radiance of God's glory. He is the creator, sustainer, the exact correspondence of his nature, and he is the priest. Prophet, priest, king are laid out for here. Beautiful ways that Calvin eventually summarized the work of Christ that is true to the Bible and essential to understanding Christ's work. After establishing then or beginning that thesis, he then begins to compare Christ to angels. He's greater than angels. Chapter 1, I think, is primarily he's greater than angels and who he is. And by Old Testament text after text after text, he is the one who has a greater name. He has a greater honor. He has a greater status. No angel compares to him. Jesus, the Son, the God and Son incarnate, is in a category all by himself, right? And then you have in chapter 2, after the warning, verse 5, carrying out the same argument, he then begins to shift to say, why is this Savior needed, right? In some sense, these readers of Hebrews were compromising Christ alone. Right? Why is this Christ needed? Because not only who he is, but he does a work that no angel can do, and ultimately only this kind of Redeemer can do to save us. Right? And so as he has Psalm 8 frame the entire section here, he moves from, really, Psalm 8 beautifully picks up the storyline of the Bible that we mentioned in those truths, right? What's Psalm 8 reflecting on? Adam. Our role in creation, to rule over creation, yet we failed. And Psalm 8, as it's positioned in the Psalter, ultimately functions prophetically to anticipate the restoration of that creation, tied to the prophets, tied to the covenantal promises that look forward to one who then, as you have in verse 9, clearly the author of Hebrews will say, from Psalm 8, you and I as human beings don't have everything under our feet, but verse 9, we see Jesus. There's the contrast. We see Jesus who was made incarnate, a little lower than the angels, crowned with glory and honor because he suffered death, so that by the grace of God he might taste death for everyone. And what does he do in his work? He restores us. You have the new Adam, the last Adam theme here, even though Adam's not mentioned. That's the concept here. So in verse 10, he brings us back to glory. Sons, us back to glory, which comes from Psalm 8. He restores us to our creation role and greater. He does so by taking on our nature so that he is like us. We're part of the family. He's able to do that, to fulfill that Adamic role. And you have that kind of necessity picked up in verse 14. Since the children have flesh and blood, he too must share in their humanity so that by his death he might. And then the first thing that's mentioned here is the destruction of the evil one. We need the evil one destroyed. We need the powers defeated. We need sin and death as powers defeated. But even here, it's important, as you have in Colossians 2 and other places, this text is not only a power encounter with the evil one, it's moving. The whole point of it is moving, which the whole book of Hebrews moves to, is it's moving to his priestly work. He's the victor, the priestly victor, the warrior who ultimately lays down his life as priest, right? So in verse 14, the children of flesh and blood, he too shares in their humanity. By his death, he destroys him who has the power of death. And of course, that has to be linked to sin and death. Death only has power because it's tied to sin. And sin is before God, right? And then you have in verse 17, for this reason. Again, picking up some kind of logic, rationality to this incarnation and cross work and ultimately priesthood. For this reason, he had to be made like us, like his brothers in every way, in order that he may become a merciful, faithful, obedient priest in service to God to make, debate here on whether this should be translated propitiation or expiation, but even so, propitiation through expiation is the biblical concept through the New Testament. To turn back God's wrath by covering our sin, by paying for our sin because he himself suffered when he was tempted. Here we have a necessity. Now, is this sort of the consequence kind of absolute necessity or hypothetical? Well, certainly it's hypothetical, right? In the sense of this is God's plan. This is the only way in God's plan that we could be saved. But if we begin to connect these passages here as we've done with these biblical truths. This necessity here is not just fulfilling the patterns, that's true, but it's ultimately bringing us back to God, which is a divine problem. God himself must solve it. There's what possible world is there that there's other way of salvation other than him taking our place, him taking on our humanity, him satisfying God's own righteous and holy and just requirements because we've sinned against God, right? That's what seems to be the logic here. And in fact, in the very same book as you have in Hebrews 9, verse 15, as all of the priesthood is tied now to the covenantal giving of old to new and the contrast between that which pointed forward to the reality of the new covenant, you have the same kind of logic that is mentioned here in verse 15 as in chapter 9 where the author is contrasting the worship of the old and then the sacrifices of the old and the better nature of Christ's work. He says in verse 15, for this reason, Christ is the mediator of the new covenant, that those who are called may receive the promised eternal inheritance now that he has died as a ransom to set them free from the sins committed under the first covenant. In the case of a covenant, it's necessary and ultimately to bring the dead ones forward. Here's covenant inauguration. But the idea here is that it was necessary. There had to be his blood brought forward. He had to pay for sin because sin was left not punished. It's the same thing that Paul says in Romans 3, 25 and 26, the closest thing we have to the very purpose and rationale of the cross. The cross is necessary because we are under sin. God's justice is at stake. The cross not only justifies us, but it justifies God. It shows that his forgiveness of us is just because he himself in his Son has taken our place so that he alone is our great Redeemer, right? And you have the same thing, I think, backed up in Gethsemane, where that episode in Gethsemane, the prayer of Christ, the cry of Christ to his Father, and given the fact of who he is, this seems to move more than just simply a hypothetical necessity. But if there be any other way, the Son in relation to the Father, there is no other way. Now, is that just no other way in terms of God's plan, or is that also tied? There's no other way to forgive. If I'm going to forgive, there must be a divine forgiveness through this one who has become incarnate. It's not just him identifying with us in Gethsemane. He must go to a cross. He must die. He must take our place. Well, all of that undergirds Christ alone, right? And it's tied, the defense of Christ alone is, yes, a full apologetic defense, but it's tied to the whole Bible, right? The whole Bible gives you the rhyme and reason and rationale, the grounding, the warrant for saying he alone can save. His work is enough. It's enough because of who he is, what he does. You don't add to his work. To add to his work, would be blasphemy. It would be foolishness. You cannot add anything to his work. It is now perfect. And then, of course, tied with union with Christ, we receive the benefits of that in covenantal union with him. Scripture clearly teaches Christ alone. The reformers were right. They were right to stand against the Roman Catholic Church. They were right to stand against the heresies. We must stand against the challenges of our day by affirming Solus Christus and his person, work, and relation to us as our covenant head. In the Lord Jesus Christ, we see all of God's plans and purposes fulfilled. We see the resolution of God to take upon himself our guilt and sin in order to reverse the horrible effects of the fall, to satisfy his own righteous requirements, to make this world right, and to inaugurate a new covenant in his blood. He is and does a work that no one can do but him. Christ is our glory. To compromise in the smallest of way his uniqueness, exclusivity, and sufficiency as the Son incarnate, our new covenant mediator, our prophet, priest, and king, is to deny who he is and to rob us of what we need. Before the triune covenant Lord, we need a redeemer who can save us completely, who can pay for our sin in full, stand in our place as our representative and substitute, secure the work of the Spirit, and fulfill perfectly the eternal plan of salvation. And the truth is that we only appreciate Christ alone, and we only grasp it, right, if we're rightly thinking, but we also see ourselves as sinners. Christianity, it's been said, is a sinner's religion. It's only when you see yourself as lost before God that you say, that's the kind of redeemer I need. Christ alone. All right.
Thank you, Dr. Wellum, very much. That was really, really wonderful. We appreciate those glorious truths. Again, we'll have time for some questions from now till 12:30, so 20 minutes. So if you want to ask a question, make your way up front. And as we've done before, I'll start, if that's all right.
Yeah, sure.
Okay, all right. I want to think a bit more with you about your necessity discussion that even came up here at the end a little bit. And the question goes something like this. How can you avoid understanding the Solus Christus in an absolute necessity framework? How can you avoid that? Because with consequent necessity, the necessity of that consequent necessity is grounded in the character of God. Why must there be Christ, Savior, atoning sacrifice? Because God is holy, and he has intrinsic demands from his own character that require this payment, okay? So necessity is grounded in the holiness of God, but it's consequent necessity because God chooses to do this. Now, but here's my question. How do you avoid that not becoming absolute necessity because God is not only holy, God is love. That is, his character is love. So might one not argue from the kind of on the same basis you are for the necessity of payment, that there has to be a salvation plan. There has to be the gift of Christ, that in a sense, God had to save.
Yeah.
So it's not consequent necessity.
Right.
Once he chooses to save, he must do it this way. It's absolute necessity.
Right.
How do you avoid that?
Well, I think we should avoid it in the sense that, I mean, everything that Scripture gives is that God himself freely chooses. Now, I guess so you have to avoid any notion of absolute necessity tied to something he's circumscribed by something outside himself, so any fatalistic notion. So you'd be having to take this to God's own attribute of love. Necessitates him to save, right? Mm-hmm. Now, I do think that as you think through love, justice, the attributes of God, obviously they express his entire nature, right? This is where I think the triune relations are important, right? So God is love, yes. He's complete within himself. He doesn't have to create. He chooses to create. His love isn't realized. He chooses to love us, which is great and glorious, and display grace to us. But he doesn't have to display love by saving us, saving the creature. He's complete within himself as the triune God who loves within himself. Justice is something now. He is just. He is holy, all right? He's holy within himself. But now in choosing to create us with sin, he doesn't have to save, but justice now must now deal with human sin in relation to him. So I think there's a different way that we think of God's choice in his attributes, expression of his attributes of love tied to, he expresses all that he is in his triune relationships. He's complete within himself. He doesn't need a world. He doesn't need to save us. All of that so that love is not expressed if he doesn't of necessity save us. It's expressed fully within himself. But that's different when it comes to justice and sin and punishment. When sin is in the world, it must now be dealt with because it would be a denial of himself. Now, would he be denying himself if he didn't necessarily love us? No, love doesn't function that way, and it's not diminished. He loves within himself. Now, you couldn't think of if he did not punish, now that sin is in the world, that's a different kind of relationship than there is with love. So that's why I would try to tie it back to God's own completion within himself. Love, perfect relationship. Now, we benefit out of that love relationship, sure. But that's a choice that is tied to his free choice. Okay. That's why we're trying to speak more of in terms of consequent.
Right.
So an expression of his grace is not the same as the expression of his justice in that way.
Right. Yeah, very good. So there has to be some distinction made between, expression of justice, holiness, justice, an expression of love and mercy, and so on. Or you could also argue the other way. Another way I could have framed the question was, how do you avoid saying that God could have willy-nilly just forgiven without any retributive payment?
Yes.
Because if he is free in respect to expressing love or not, couldn't you say then he's also free in expressing holiness or not?
Yeah, you can't say that, right? Because that would be deny his very character as a standard. We'd rob him of his glory.
Right.
He would be compromising his own self, right? So, but in love, he's not compromising himself. Now, he is expressing, he chooses, but it's not. And if you move in the necessity way, I mean, in some sense, you're going to have sort of Karl Barth, aren't you, where you're almost going to have a universalism.
Right, yeah.
Maybe there's ways out of it, but it would seem that, it really to fully satisfy his love, he's going to have to save all of us.
Yes,
in the end,
that's right? Thomas Talbot and those at least professing evangelical universalists.
Yes, that's right.
Okay, thank you very much. Yeah. Very helpful. Please come up and engage Dr. Wellum in any questions you might have. Don't be bashful.
They want lunch. That's what they want.
They want lunch. That's right. We see one brave soul making his way up here.
There he is.
Hey, Dr. Wellum. Charlie Rowland.
Maybe raise that up a little bit more.
Yeah.
You have to turn the... Okay. Yeah. Never mind. Just yank it.
Regarding the preceding events of the atonement, would you lump those in with the necessity of God? So we would all agree that the cross was necessary for justice, but would you lump in the sufferings of Christ preceding the cross as necessary, or would you say that could possibly be done as an example?
Yeah, this is where getting into necessary discussions is tricky, right? So I thought in terms of the presentation I would frame it, because I mean, it seems to me that Christ alone, we're going to have to say something of necessity, otherwise there could be another way, or there could be some other possible means of salvation or something. So that's how this question of necessity comes. Now, nailing down all of the features in terms of, is this part of the way that is part of God's plan that he has decreed, which would be true to a hypothetical necessity versus something now in the very nature of God. Now, certainly, I think we're on good grounds where we think of sin before God. God is a holy, just one, cannot overlook our sin. There must be himself satisfying his own righteous requirements, right? Now, how much of then suffering and all of that takes place is very difficult to nail down. Now, in terms of the biblical storyline, right? I mean, this gets into somewhat of the discussion of active and passive obedience of Christ, in the sense of his life before the cross, right? His obedience, his suffering. Now, his suffering there is now, if you think of Philippians 2, I mean, the humbling of himself in first incarnation. That's a humbling act for the divine Son, right? And acting in and through as the divine Son in relation to the Father, dependence on the Spirit, Trinitarian relations for the sake of mission, I'm happy to say primarily through his humanity, though not limited to it. So that's humbling. He suffers, right? He experiences hunger and all of those things. Now, in the storyline, clearly those acts of obedience, they supremely show themselves in the cross, yet they show themselves in his entire life. Now, in the way the covenants unfold, particularly tied to Adam and the obedience demanded of human creatures, the obedience, his disobedience that brings us down, certainly in God's plan and covenants, this is necessary, right? The act of obedience, he must now act as our representative and substitute, right? He must obey for us. Now, how much, you know, in terms of time, and I don't know beyond that, but I do think in terms of at least how the patterns that are given to us, his life is absolutely important, right? You cannot just have him be conceived, born, you know, 5 years old, go to the cross or something like this. No, I mean, his whole ministry, his standing for us, his acting as our head at the beginning of his ministry, his obedience through those 3 years is the reversing of Adam's disobedience, winning for us righteousness. He comes under the law to obey the law, right? And so now, the amount of that and all of those there, so I would say, minimally, we have to say it's tied to God's plan. So that could fit with hypothetical. There may be some even more than that tied to the fact of him as last Adam. Certainly obedience is necessary in that way. So, yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Good. Any others? Good. I see a couple here. Yes, please.
Thank you, Dr. Yes. Wellum.
Yeah.
My question may be too simple because I'm not very good at theology. Thanks.
We are all theologians.
Thank you.
Or we should be anyway. Yeah.
My question is from Mark 34. And calling the crowd to him with his disciples, he said to them, "If anyone would come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me."
Yeah.
So is there any wrong understanding or wrong interpretation of the phrase, "take the cross and follow me"? The cross for us, and right. Christ has accomplished his work on the cross. What's that cross we need to take? Is there any wrong understanding of in the church history? Is that cross can be specified to each individually differently and for each person? Thank you.
Yeah. I'm sure there's a lot of things in church history you probably would look at and different views in that. I mean, I take that as, I mean, the cross is presented in a multifaceted way in Scripture, and Christ himself serving as our example is a crucial, the imitation of Christ theme comes through. We just have to carefully put all those pieces together in such a way that we draw proper conclusions. We cannot draw the conclusion that in Christ taking up his cross, we take up our cross and we become penal substitutes for one another. Well, obviously that's not the case. His going to the cross is utterly unique, right? So that we then have to say, what's he saying here, right? Well, he's saying that he's setting us an example. He is very similar to the foot washing, right? I am the Lord. I humble myself to even wash your feet. Follow this example. So that after he wins for us salvation, he's the only redeemer, yet we are to be those who, as our Lord and Savior, we follow him, right? We are willing to suffer for him. We're willing to be persecuted for him. We're willing to face a society and a culture that stands opposed to the things of Christ and be willing to gladly do that as he was willing to gladly do that for us, but in a far greater way, right? So we're really unpacking imitation and example at that point. And there's all kinds of exemplary ways that are tied to the cross. The cross becomes a major example for us in Peter and other places, Ephesians 5, husbands and wives and this. Yet you have to then speak of the differences, right? And you have to speak of the utter uniqueness of what Christ is doing and then what we're doing as his disciples, his children, and following him.
Hey, Dr. Wellum, thank you for that. Yeah. My question is related to, as we think of Solus Christus, it seems primarily the emphasis is on Christ and his saving work. My question is more related to all of Christ's offices and how that actually plays into the Solus Christus. When you look at movements such as Jesus as Savior, not Lord, even when it comes to the distinctions between church membership and covenantal dynamics, how do we take Solus Christus and apply all of the offices of Christ into that?
Yeah, well, what's crucial, right? And I tried to link it together. Obviously, we think of it in terms of his work, but you can't have work without who he is. You can't have who he is. He didn't come to become incarnate for just, you know, to learn about what life on earth is like. He came to fulfill, you know, the plan of God to be our Redeemer and to die, right? You shall call his name Jesus, and he will save his people from their sins, right? That's part of the eternal plan of God that now works itself out in history, right? So you can't separate the two. So that becomes very, very important. I do think in some of the debates we have of Lord and Savior and that, I mean, how on earth, you know, Christologically in terms of his work, let alone the whole doctrine of salvation as it's applied, could you say, oh, you know, I have him as part of what he does, but I don't have him in terms of him, right? We have him as the Lord and Savior who has given himself for us, who is in relation to us, who has died for us. He's our representative. He's our substitute, all of these things. So you can't have him who is not prophet, priest, king. You can't have him who is not Lord, Savior. You have him, right? So that faith is in him as a person and all that he has won for us, right? So that's clearly, you can't separate these things out. And prophet, priest, and king, and we're going to develop that in the book as well. I mean, that's just a way of getting around. It's called the threefold office, not offices, because it's unpacking the one person and work of Christ. He is this in all of these dimensions, right? And it's important to keep them all together. He's the one who is the final revelation of God. He is truth incarnate. He is the one who brings the rule of God to this world. He is the one who is our great Redeemer, our great High Priest. And then they intersect with one another, right? I mean, priests in the Old Testament also had some warrior notions to them. And, you know, Adam in the garden seems to be a kind of early priest. And so now, as it comes over into the church, yeah, there's some issues there of ecclesiology that you'd have to be very, very careful of that just don't, you know, come over that way, right? Christ is the head of the church. He is our mediator. We come in relation to him, and then we think of then our relationships as the people of God. Right? So, yeah.
Very good. Thank you. Any others who have a question? One more. Very good. Thank you.
Dr. Wellum, you mentioned Green and some of those other guys. So maybe one or two arguments that you feel are some of their stronger arguments, and how would you respond to them? There's not many of them. I'm not implying that they have strong arguments.
I don't find recovering the scandal of the, I find the recovering the scandal across the scandalous book. I mean, what they attempt to do, when that book came out in 2000, then it's been revised, and Green is the main person behind that. I mean, its attempt was very good. It tried to move from biblical text to theological formulation, to wrestle with that. All of that is what we want to do when we do theology. The problem is that it got unhinged from the biblical data. It got reconstructed in light of contemporary culture. So it became a good, I use it in class as an illustration of what not to do, right? In terms of theological method, right? Now, what are they saying that's good? Well, I mean, they do emphasize rightly that the Bible presents the cross in the atoning work of Christ, the work of Christ in diverse ways, and we need to preserve all those diverse ways, right? So even when we speak of penal substitution, I want to argue that that's at the heart of the nature of the cross. If we get at what the cross is all about, right, that's what's central to it. Yet, you know, out of that comes victory. Out of that is viewed, and the biblical vocabulary is rich, reconciliation, redemption, justice, obedience, all of these sacrifices. So all, you know, what Green in his kaleidoscope view, keeping all those things together, is good. Yet, he doesn't think in the end, and I think this probably goes back to a whole view of Scripture and everything else, that there's a unified presentation, right? He doesn't think theology is possible. I think that goes back to a variety of assumptions, primarily a doctrine of Scripture assumption here. I take the Scripture as giving all of its diversity, yet there is a rhyme and reason to it. There's a coherency to it. The theological tax is legitimate because it's a God-given revelation. So the strength of it is, hey, don't minimize all the beautiful ways the Bible presents the cross, yet the Bible itself locks, interlinks these things together. So in Romans 3, redemption, propitiation, justice, justification are all linked together, right? And in the same book, you have other images as well. So that the task of, he doesn't do the task of theology. That's the negative. And he doesn't do justice to things in their own biblical context. But if we take one positive, you know, the encouragement to look at all the richness of how the atonement is presented, and that would be true of every doctrine, but we then, the weakness is we've got to bring it together. Yeah.
All right, very good. Thank you. Let's express our thanks again to Dr. Wellum.